We begin this time of meditation by flowing breath. Let your breath flow in and out consciously, with attention on expansion. Notice the expansion of your lungs and the entire abdominal cavity as you draw breath in. Draw more than you believe you can. Breathe from the depths, drawing on the life that you are, the divine life that is the essence of every substance, every visible and invisible aspect of you. Breathing in, breathing out. And aware, as we do so, that the source of that breath is divine life itself, God itself. And where do you and God reside? In the all. So pay attention right now as your breathing just subsides, as you let it be and let it flow. Pay attention to the edges of your own skin. Feel on a place where your skin touches the atmosphere around you, and notice what sensations there are right at that edge. Notice the temperature. In noticing, we realize that every single centimeter of skin on our bodies, every part of its surface is permeable, is open. And so we now decide to open. And we know that we spill out, our thoughts spill out, our intentions spill out, our very breath flows out. And yet what flows in is also flow, the life flow. When we reach the end of our own personal resources of strength or vitality, we draw from life. And that life that God is, that is life, is all around us. So as we expand beyond the sense of ourselves as confined to a body, as if we have solid borders, we now begin to appreciate the allness that we are. The sense that we are more than we have believed about ourselves. That we are nothing short of one with the one. And we rest for a few moments in appreciation of this as the reality that we long to know. And we allow ourselves to know it in a state of spiritual realization right here and now, as we sit for a moment together in silence. As we draw our awareness back to our own bodies now, we just draw from the endless supply of all that we need for this day in the atmosphere around us, in the God presence and power that exists within us as well as around us. We draw from that so that we know that we are fully equipped with all that we need for the day ahead of us. So we land all of that power within our very body and being. As we accept the great truth of our divine identity, that we are more than human, we are divine. And I'll say it directly to you in case your mind just doesn't want to agree with that. I'm going to ask you to agree when I say you are divine. So breathe with me now, another deep, rich breath in and a breath out. And then as you breathe again, we join together in a new Lord's Prayer. Madison, wow. I tell you what, this is my first opportunity to be here in your community, and I have just felt overjoyed and overwhelmed, that's not a word, is it? No, how could you be overwhelmed, right? But I feel your welcome. I love your welcome song, Pete, just beautiful welcome song. I feel you, and I love the Unity Jazz Band, Steve and Sherry and all your friends. Oh my word. Yeah, let's play. So I am in agreement with you about your vision. I am so thankful to Reverend Evan for inviting me to be here, you know, so soon in your tenure here. So thank you for that. I'm thrilled to serve and celebrate Sunday with you. It's my pleasure. I'm glad you came today. We had a really wonderful day yesterday with, about 25 or so of you who were here for prayer training. It was really rich and deep. And those of you who are here with me can tell the rest of you that we go kind of deep, kind of fast. Are you with me? Are you with me? All right. So let me say it again, because this is what I'm really feeling. I know you. I know your name. I know your nature. You are the light of God. You are the light of God. Now, it's nothing personal. It doesn't make you special. It doesn't make you unique. In fact, I believe it's the human assignment. You know, we divine humans, that's the job description. Light of the world. You know what I mean? You get that with me? The light of the world. So what this means is that we're here to shine something into the world around us. And really, what we shine can make quite a difference. I mean, everything we shine really makes a contribution. And the body of our shining comes from the invisibles of us. It's what we know about ourselves, what we think, what we contribute, not necessarily in our acts and in our jobs, but the very foundation of how we think and feel. What we do and say that flows from that. That's what we contribute. For good or not so good. You with me about that? For good or not so good. So when my thoughts are lofty, when I'm able to access really the truest truth that I can know in a moment, and I think the noblest, loftiest set of thoughts, what kind of frequency you think there is to that? That's bright light. Right? There's a brightness to that. There's a vibration that broadcasts a floodlight signal to the rest of the world. But when I am my snarkiest self, and when I am, you know, that petty little flow of thoughts, when I'm attuning to that, it's the lowest vibration. You know this, right? It's the lowest, and it drags me down before I touch anybody else. You know what I mean? Drags me down. But when I'm in that state of mind, how bright you think my light is? I'm a dim bulb is what I am. I'm just dim. I mean, it's just not even enough for a night light. And really, if I think about it, it's that dramatically a distinction. And so it impresses upon me the importance of the quality of my thoughts. This is no surprise to those of you who have been studying the Unity Message, because that's one of our teachings, is the way I think is spills out into the way I experience my life. You know, my thoughts do matter, but they don't only matter to me. This is what is so important for us to get at a time when, you know, I'm a big social media hog. I mean, I love reading the posts, and I stay in touch with my family and friends from childhood and, you know, the whole thing. So I really love it. And, you know, in the last 3 years alone, since I arrived at Silent Unity, there have been mountains of disasters. One after another. In Silent Unity, we were having to every single week construct a new prayer for a new emergency in our world. Everything from natural disasters to unfortunate human ones, human-created ones. And they're horrifying and troubling to us. And now, with social media right at our fingertips, they're right in front of us. You know, we think, well, what's happened to our world? Well, they've always been happening. It's just now we have instant access to that knowledge. And it gets to us. Do you know? I'll speak for myself. It can cause loss of sleep because it's such a worrisome thing. And then add politics to that, and it's like, it's just, you know, we're all needing some help. Yeah, we all feel like, you know, it's just such a challenge to get through a day sometimes with the press of the collective consciousness of fear and dread and worry and all of that. So listen, if you are having any inexplicable sense of anxiety, you might just remind yourself it may not be yours. It might not be personal to you. It might be you're feeling the world. That helps me to remember. Because then I can really turn my thoughts to how can I support the world. And in doing that, I can really change my own personal energy and thought process, you know, to be of help, to be of service and support through prayer. When I was in the fourth grade, which was early 60s, long time ago, 60 years ago, right, I was taught in science class that the basis of all reality are atoms. That atoms were the creative, invisible to the naked eye, but definitely matter, definitely something you could see with the right equipment, right? And atoms were the basis, the foundation, or the building blocks of all that we can see and experience in life. That's what we were taught. That was pure science in those days. And so what we learned was atoms then cluster together with other atoms to form molecules. And those molecules, they latch on to other molecules to take different shapes and forms that land, that turn out to be our chairs and our people, right? That's the basis of life. So nothing comes from invisible. Everything's visible in a certain form, but it grows into more and more matter. Well, listen, we've come a long way in 60 years. Because quantum physics has totally debunked that misunderstanding about the basis of life. The basis of life is the invisibles. the testing that has been done in the body of science today is telling us, the quantum physics that were just theories. And listen, Fillmore, Charles Fillmore, over 100 years ago, understood this, even though he didn't have the language for it or the science to back him up on it. When he wrote Atom Smashing Power of Mind, he meant that the atoms are not in charge. The atoms are not where it all comes from. It comes from thought. So it comes from thought, which equates to consciousness. Consciousness is the creator of all. Now, for you and for me, what that means is pretty startling, because sometimes do you feel like I have certainly felt like my thoughts are out of my control? Like they just won't shut up in there. You know what I mean? Like it's just this running commentary about life day after day, and I don't have any charge in. I mean, I can't control it. It's just this flurry. Sometimes I feel that way. But nothing is further from the truth. The fact is that the thoughts that we hold, that we, not just the thoughts that flow through, because I have lots of thoughts that flow through, and I'm sure glad they do flow through, because I remember in second grade, third grade, fourth grade, I remember having some very unkind thoughts and some unkind wishes that people would disappear from my life, because that was just the way we talked, right? I mean, it was a lot worse than, you can't come to my birthday party. You know, it was a lot worse than that. It was about falling downstairs, wish you would die, right? It was that kind of thoughts, right? That Lordy, isn't it a good idea? Isn't it a good thing that those thoughts don't materialize, right? Right, so the fleeting thoughts is not what we're talking about, but we're talking about a collection of thoughts that over time build a body of experience, a body of belief, a body that becomes a worldview that becomes much harder to penetrate and takes on a life of its own, that centers itself in the subconscious of us, so we're not even aware of the stinking thinking going on under there. But it shows up when we react to something that's going on right now. And the biggest thing that I've been paying attention to and interested in and wanting to really talk about is on social media when these terrible things happen. You see, especially in New Thought, all my New Thought friends, thousands of them, all saying thoughts and prayers, thoughts and prayers, thoughts and prayers. I'm contributing thoughts and prayers. And my very first thought, because I am a thoughts and prayers kind of gal, you know, I'm like, I get it, and I'm so grateful for it. Because for me, when I say thoughts and prayers, I know what I'm doing with that. I know I'm going into meditation, I'm going into silence, I'm going to the creative field of imagination, my spiritual capacity for that, and I am doing something constructively in that, right? And I know a lot of people are doing that, but then you get the people who don't know the practice that I refer to, and they're like, enough of the thoughts and prayers already, we need to do something. You know, you get them. Do you get them on your feeds too? And you think, oh, yeah, I get it. Because action matters. It's one of our teachings. You've got to act on the truth, you know. So that's important. But Lordy, you don't just throw away thoughts and prayers. In my discipline, you don't. You don't throw them away. You don't skip that step. Because here's what happens if I skip that step, I jump right into reactionary behavior. I start fighting against. I start contributing thought and action into the field that is dim, dim, dim light. Whereas when I use the tools that the Unity teachings have given me in my life, I can shine brighter than that. And I can help to make a difference. You know what I mean? Yes. Thank you, Josie. Josie knows what I mean. So I want to give you an example of how the Unity teachings can work. And yesterday, those of us who were gathered for the prayer training, we really talked about how we become, how we lean into our being nature, how we see ourselves and draw from the spiritual capacities that we have when we know God as our source. In Unity, we teach the 12 powers. Who's familiar with the 12 powers of Unity? Okay, good. About a third of you have studied or whatever. So the 12 powers are just ways to describe the indescribable. So if the foundation of all life is the invisibles, these powers are among the invisibles. They're not something you can look at and see for itself. For example, strength. You can't point to strength, but you can look at someone and say they're demonstrating strength, correct? So that's the way it is with all these powers. They're the invisibles. They don't have a form and shape of their own. And yet these are the fodder from which we can view ourselves as the divine that we are. When we say we're one with God, what the heck does that mean? I mean, it really is meaningless unless I assign to that God some qualities that I can see for myself, I could claim, and I could embody. I could live out those ideals. And that's what the 12 powers are. And that's why I've begun, or have been for years now, using those powers as pointers to what do I need to be and to contribute? What kind of thoughts do I need to hold for the world around me and for my own life? Tell the truth about that, right? For my own circumstances each day. So I want to tell you a little story about how I have used these. And this is one of the most critical periods of my life. It's a long time ago now, but it's one of the most significant periods in my life, among many, that I point to as one of the most challenging times of my life, where I had the most high spiritual practice of my life. You know, we talked yesterday about it's when the times are really tough that we absolutely have to prove this truth that we study, right? And that's what I'm talking about. So I want to describe just as an example for you of how you can cultivate your spiritual powers. The 12 powers are just some of the powers Charles Fillmore identified. But whatever you can say about God, you have to begin to be able to say about yourself. That power that you give to God, you must begin to claim for yourself. Charles Fillmore said that, truthfully, and so do many other teachers in New Thought. So here's an example of how I worked with them. Four of the powers are located energetically in the brain. I call them the four brain powers. So I want to just talk to you about how I used these four brain powers when I was healing my relationship with my father. One of the most difficult things that I always hear from people in prayer situations is about disharmony in their family, about somebody being kicked out of the kingdom of the family or whatever, right? Well, I was that person when I was very young. My husband and I married in 1979, and my dad promptly disowned me. I was one of seven children, and a very tight community of Italian Catholics in Philadelphia. And so I was, you know, I went outside that system, and I married somebody of African descent, and Dad just couldn't deal, right? So that was the circumstance. And for 9 years, I worked with this in my own prayer life. I had studied yoga and Unity, and so I had a lot of a lot of tools in my toolkit. And so let me just describe what I had to do, because there were some very troubling circumstances around this. When he disowned me, when I say that, I mean he would not speak to me if I called. And I was across the country and across the ocean when my husband was stationed in Honolulu, and he would hang the phone up on me and do all these other things to just give me a very clear message: we have no relationship. So I was in it was traumatic. I felt terrible sorrow, and especially as my children were born and they didn't get to meet their grandpa and this kind of stuff. So what I had to do, because I couldn't move him, I couldn't do anything with him, he wouldn't let me. I had dreams of showing up at his doorstep and knocking on the door and demanding him to love me. How would that work, you know? That wasn't going to work, so I had to do that. I had to go inside. I had to do this myself. And you might have to do that too, depending on the circumstance that's really the one you really need to break through. I was determined for a breakthrough. And when I say that, I was needing the breakthrough for me. I was needing to break through the condemnation of my father that was very easy to hold. I had to do that because it was going to kill me. It was going to shrink my life. So I worked with my brain power of faith. It's right in the middle of the brain, that energy of that. But I harnessed faith, which is the power of perception. And I forced myself to try to perceive the real of my dad underneath this situation, and the real of my relationship with him. Now, that wasn't easy, but what I forced myself to do is to say, what do I know in the truest truth that has nothing to do with the way he's behaved or the way this situation is? What do I know about him and about us? And I kept coming back to perceiving the truth of my father as a divine being, and one who's hurting in some way, one who has some fears that he hasn't overcome, not one who hates me, not one who is mean, not that. I mean, I really started to see, and we was willing to comprehend that my dad was, just as I was, innocent. Tough word to apply. Tough word to apply in this. But I was determined, even if I didn't feel it in a minute, even if I was complaining or screaming, you know, writing him nasty letters that I kept in my own journal wisely, you know, that was my job. And that's the aspect of faith that says, I will perceive what is true beyond this appearance. Now, I had done that a gajillion times in other things, but this is where the rubber meets the road, and this was the toughest assignment at a time when I was feeling the wounds of being disowned. So then I had the other faculties in here were the faculty of imagination, and that's the third eye. So I began to imagine what that reunion would be like. I mean, that's all. I didn't have any control over it. I mean, I showed up at my grandmother's funeral and my dad walked out the back door of the funeral home. So I didn't have any control over his actions, right? But I, in my meditation, in my journal, every day I started to imagine the joy of reunion with my dad and the joy of introducing grandfather to his grandchildren and the joy of just our hearts just being free of this craziness, right? I was imagining it, and I was drawing a picture mentally and in my words of what I wanted. Now, I didn't pray for it. I just imagined it. That's the faculty of imagination, the ability to envision life as I want to live it. And by the way, for those in the prayer training yesterday, when we talk about we don't pray for an outcome, we don't. But the use of our faculty of imagination to envision that ideal that I want to live in, and really it wasn't so much about Dad and I in harmony, it was really about me being free to just be in love with him, You see what I'm saying? It was that kind of imagination. But that's our work. So we can envision our body fully healed after a disease process. We can envision all the things. But what we want to envision is not just that the pain goes away. We want to envision if I've had hip replacement surgery, I want to envision hiking along the Appalachian Trail. I want to envision dancing, going ballroom dancing with my sweetheart, right? I want to envision living in that new reality, right? So I envision my dad taking my children to the circus, for example, because that my dad loved that, those kinds of things. And I used my imagination faculty very well. Then the other faculty is understanding. Well, that's a big one because there's mental understanding and there's spiritual understanding. So for my mental understanding, I started to study the world that my father was born into. I wanted to understand what shaped him to have the attitudes that he had. What was going on in Philadelphia in the early 1900s that helped to impart to my father a fear of people of African descent. That helped me. It helped me mentally be able to make room for him. Just, of course he feels the way he feels because this is what life presented to him, right? Totally helped me. Totally, totally helped me. And then spiritual understanding, and that's a tougher thing. Spiritual understanding asks the question, what am I? It has nothing to do with him. What am I? And what is my response? What do I know about my nature and therefore my capacity? And let me know that I'm greater than this and that my ability to see through the eyes of truth is what is going to heal me and certainly leave room for healing with my dad. So understanding, the understanding mind. And then the fourth brain power, this is the big frog, this is will. Oh, will. So will is our choice-making power. And so I just really got it. I had to choose. Am I going to lay all the shame and guilt and condemnation on my dad for this? Or am I just going to will myself into staying steady in love with him? Am I willing to do that? And then am I committed to every day if I notice thoughts that start squirreling back toward condemnation or whatever? Am I willing to pull myself back? Am I going to use my power of will to just hold to that knowledge and to be disciplined in my thoughts, to hold a disciplined mind around this? And so that's what I did. And I didn't know these powers at the time, but as I reflected back after studying the 12 hours, that's precisely what I did. And I did it as a discipline every day, day after day after day after day. 9 years later, my dad and I reconnected. He had a deep healing. I had, in my meditations, I would hold him in my heart. I would see him in front of me. I felt that we were one, that there was nothing that could ever really come between us in truth. And I allowed myself to hold that. My will was that we were an unbroken divine love, always have been. And that if we could just clean this thing up, we'll just love all the next generations into being. You know what I mean? Like, we'll just clean this up. And that's exactly what we did. And to his credit, this man opened his heart, had just a deep healing, and I feel totally responsible for it. And I, in the sense that I was responsible for cleaning up my own thoughts and contributing light. Because had I contributed only that condemnation, that dim bulb of that would not have penetrated his beautiful heart. That's how I feel about it. That's what I know. You are capable of this and all. Cleaning up all that crap in your life. You're capable of every bit of it. And I was prepared for my dad taking that one to his grave, because that's what he was giving signs of doing. And so how I worked with that was literally release my dad. That's another of our 12 powers, the release power. And I released him from any further obligation to me in my life. I would not hold him accountable or required to have to make my life any better. That wasn't his job, in my opinion, and he didn't need to do that because I was fully intact as a human being, as a spiritual being. And I didn't need him, even though I wanted to be in the state of love with him. Do you get what I mean by that? And it was in that release that he really came back around to me, and I'm so thankful that that was possible. So friends, that's all just to say, I mean, that's an extreme example, but you might have some extremes in your life as well. And when you think about the world, aren't we in some pretty extreme conditions in the world right now? You have it in you to be the light of the world. You study your spiritual capacities. You know, if you pick up Divine Audacity, there's instructions for all the powers in there and how you can activate them in your own life, you know, through spiritual practice as well as through then how do you live if you're taking on that power and drawing from it every day in your life. You can get so good at this in the places where you haven't been before. You know what I mean? I'm not saying you're not already a light in the world. You're shiny. You're pretty shiny to me. I feel you. So I feel you. But every one of us can use some refinement. You know what I mean? I mean, every one of us has those places where, you know, our thoughts are a little crosswise and we can do something about it. That's all. You can do something about it. You, as the light of the world, you are here to shine that light and you have every bit of it in you. And so the quality of that light depends on the way you're thinking from day to day. So clean it up. Just clean it up and sharpen that lens and see the world the way you need to be seeing it in order to shine your brightest light to help and serve this great world that needs you. It needs you right now. I think that's enough. Do you? I'm so grateful for this time with you. Thank you, friends. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah.